Hey, this is the Fight Nerd, and I'm joined today by former Pride FC, Strikeforce, Elite XE commentator, as well as currently commentating for Invicta FC and Glory Kickboxing, and now the upcoming New Japan Pro Wrestling show on Access TV, which premieres on January 16th, Mr. Mauro Ranallo. Mr. Ranallo, how are you today?
It's always an adventure in the life of the bipolar rock and roller, but I'm enjoying spreading the word about this new project that I am really excited about. And you know, it's nice to be able to go back to my roots as a pro wrestling announcer at such a level.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you and Josh Barnett are teaming up as the American commentators for this new show on Access TV for New Japan Pro Wrestling, which is going to highlight some of the greatest matches in recent times in New Japan. And, you know, for a hardcore pro wrestling fan like yourself, this has got to be an absolute dream come true.
It really is. And I mean, if you look back at life and as a kid, I was one of those guys at 5 years old who was introduced to pro wrestling by my parents as immigrants from Italy, didn't understand English. There were three channels that we got, and wrestling was one of them. And because of the simplicity, especially at the time of, you know, you were able to delineate the good guys from the bad guys and the characters and the drama, the theatrical aspect, but also the athleticism. So pro wrestling has always been one of my biggest loves. And I think anyone who's followed my career realizes that, yeah, there is that flavor to how I approach events, because I am firmly invested as a fan first and foremost. And you know, people say at times I may be over the top, and that's really who I am as a human being. I'm always looking to try to look at those peaks and valleys and allow the action to speak for itself at times. But in approaching this project, it really could not come at a better time in my life and in my career, because 2014 for me will always go down as the most memorable year of my professional career, and a year that I still can't believe I enjoyed, especially knowing the trials and tribulations that, you know, each of us have a story to tell, and my battles with mental health issues and my diagnosis with bipolar affective disorder at 19, I thought were going to scuttle all of my plans. Little did I know that in many ways that has been both a gift and a curse, and one of the reasons why I'm able to do what I do, whether it's boxing, kickboxing, and MMA, and now back to puroresu. My gas tank doesn't empty much, my friend. I've got energy for days.
Absolutely. And, you know, you mentioned already about how you are such a serious fan of pro wrestling. And, you know, it's got to mention out there to the listeners, knowing Japanese wrestling is something you simply just cannot fake. It's something that you are, you know, you become invested in. Anybody can read Wikipedia, they can read statistics, but it takes a real fan to be able to actually talk about it. And I got to say, I watched one of the sneak peeks of one of the episodes coming out, and you guys are on the ball. You guys are clearly fans. You know what's going on. So let me ask you this now. When did you first become aware of Japanese wrestling, and who were the stars that got you so interested in it?
Well, thank you very much for those kind words, by the way, and I hope that's what the viewers will think. It was a pleasure to work with Josh Barnett, who, of course, was a New Japan Pro Wrestling a star over 50 matches, and in fact made his debut at the New Japan Pro Wrestling Tokyo Dome show back in 2003, where he failed against Yuji Nagata. But in terms of my fandom, man, I go back to, I remember when Satoru Sayama, the original Tiger Mask, and Dynamite Kid Tommy Billington were revolutionizing the business and really putting the junior heavyweights on the map with their series of matches back in the early 80s. And of course, being familiar with Antonio Inoki and Giant Baba, and even going back further than that, Ricky Dozan is the father of puroresu. So I've always had my finger on the pulse of the business, because I've been a fan since I was young, and growing up and again, starting my career at a young age at 16 with All-Star Wrestling, but following Stampede Wrestling, and really credit to the legendary Stu Hart and his sons, and because they also brought over so many Japanese legends in the embryonic stages of their career. There was Jushin Thunder Liger, who was Kichi Yamada in Calgary. Hiro Hase is one of the Viet Cong Express mass tag team. And of course, Shinya Hashimoto, one of the greatest IWGP heavyweight champions ever, who also cut his teeth in Calgary. So at an early age, I was exposed to puroresu stars, and then thanks to people like Dave Meltzer, of course, and videotapes, and now with the advent of the internet, if you want to find it, if you want to get invested, there has never been a better time, especially now with the NJPW World streaming service that I've already signed up on the first day. But I follow pro wrestling forever, and of course, being a part of Pride Fighting Championships during its halcyon days, 2003 to 2006, and really the crossover appeal of Pride and pro wrestling in Japan, it was, my very first Pride show Bushido won, October of 2003, married together my two loves at the time, as Mirko Prokop, you know, stopped none other than Dos Canas Jr., who just happened to be Alberto Del Rio under a mask. So in my very first MMA fight, there was a guy in a mask in the main event. So needless to say, coming back to New Japan Pro Wrestling and its diversity and the way that it presents puroresu and the strong style as legitimate art form and legitimate athletic competition, I could not ask for a better opportunity, and I'm so grateful for it.
Yeah, I believe we call that Destiny, which oddly enough was also a name for a NOAH pay-per-view, I'm sure. Now, you got... Yeah, you got the joke. Thank God someone out there is going to get that. Now, you guys are commenting on matches that have already been taped a while ago, many of which, of course, you being such a hardcore fan, have already seen at least once. So, you know, tell us about the challenges of commentating on something that's pre-taped and how hard it is to keep the energy of a live event into your commentary.
See, it's interesting. You're not the first person to ask that question, and I understand why it's being asked. And I think it's incumbent upon us. And I think one of the reasons maybe I've been able to put together the career that I have, and I've done this before with pro wrestling NOAH matches in the Fight Network in Toronto. In fact, it was doing voiceovers with Dan Lebransky of the Law Radio Show in Toronto that really got me, you know, noticed by the Fight Network, even though I was doing Pride Fighting Championships and all this. But after they heard me commentate pro wrestling NOAH, you know, I went to Toronto and lived there for 6 years, but I worked at the Fight Network for 3 years. So it does not take me much to be able to put myself in the zone. And I think it's because I approach what I do maybe not differently than most, but I think we're all performers. I started my career at 16 in high school. I don't have a journalism degree. I don't have a communications degree. I knew at the age of 5 years of age, what I wanted to do in life. And so my entire life has been a dress rehearsal or auditions, if you were, or practice for what I do for a living. I'm a talker, I'm a storyteller, I love English, I love the vocabulary, I love painting word pictures, and above all else, I love researching, I love preparing, I love to read everything I can get my hands on and then take the nuggets that I'm going to use in hopes of not only enlightening and educating, but also giving the fans an opportunity to learn more about, especially in this case, individuals that we are hoping many people will be seeing for the first time, because with all due respect to the passionate hardcore fan base, of which, you know, we all know in combat sport how passionate, whether it's boxing, MMA, or puroresu, the fan base is, I'm not there to necessarily speak to them, although I hope they will enjoy what we do, but it's more of an introduction for people who have never seen New Japan Pro Wrestling before. And at the same time, even if it's hardcore, the matches were that good, and they really were that good. I'm hoping that the English commentary will enhance it even more with the facts and the insight of a guy like Josh Barnett, who's actually been in the New Japan ring.
I can confirm that it does. I really enjoyed hearing you guys talk about it, and it really brought you know, a lot to the table hearing an American commentator instead of the usual Japanese commentary, which, you know, I don't understand any. So it's great to hear you guys go talk about it. And this is actually a perfect segue, because you mentioned about, you know, being able to introduce a lot of new fans to the world of New Japan. And I know a lot of these episodes are going to be talking about Hiroshi Tanahashi and Kazuchika Okada. That's a guarantee. The one I saw was the 2013 match between those two guys, the 5-star match. For fans of New Japan that are going to be new to this, watching it for the first time, can you give us the backstory to why this feud is so important to New Japan Pro Wrestling and why it's gone on as long as it has?
Well, it really begins with the fact that Hiroshi Tanahashi especially has connected with the crowd in a way. And you know, I've heard it said before, he's the Japanese John Cena. And all due respect to John Cena, who I respect a lot for longevity and what he has done in his own career. Hiroshi Tanahashi is a guy who dares to be great each and every night, who knows what the fans expect. And even though he's had his fair share, and this is the one thing about New Japan Pro Wrestling, it is professional wrestling, but because of the strong style, which lends itself to the physicality, which what I mean by that is those hard lariats and the punches, the elbows, they are connecting. There's nothing about a quote-unquote fake about this stuff. Yes, it is a choreographed form of entertainment, but the way it is presented is really as pure athleticism as you can find in this regard. So Hiroshi Tanahashi, who right now is in the midst of his record-breaking 7th IWGP heavyweight title reign, and to put that in perspective, the IWGP heavyweight title, which was created back in 1987 when Antonio Inoki, who founded New Japan back in 72, put him over his idol, by the way, the ton of wrestling that all got. But Inoki beating Masa Saito in the finals of the tournament in 87 to establish the title. Now, people have said, well, wait a minute, Hulk Hogan was an IWGP heavyweight champion. Hulk Hogan won a tournament back in 83, but at the time, there was no IWGP heavyweight championship. So when you go back to the history of the IWGP title and the people who have held it, to know that Hiroshi Tanahashi, now in the midst of a record-breaking seventh title reign, you know what he lends to the art. He has been involved in multiple five-star matches and has this unique charisma. With charisma, you either have it or you don't. He has it in spades. And above and beyond that, he delivers. He continues to deliver, whether it's the high fly flow or take on the frog splash. Just his storytelling, his psychology, facial expression. This goes for everybody in New Japan, but Hiroshi Tanahashi really is, the benchmark. He's the standard bearer, following in the footsteps of the legends of puroresu, like Kenta Kobashi, Mitsuhiro Misawa, Shin Yachimoto, so on and so forth. And the chemistry he has with this young upstart in Kazuchika Okada is really reminiscent of what we saw with Ric Flair and Ricky Steamboat back in the late 80s, 89, and their three amazing matches, or Jack Briscoe and Dory Funk Jr., and when I use those names, and I know Jim Ross, who was a legend and a great friend of mine, did the same thing this past Sunday at Wrestle Kingdom 9, it's a reason for that. You are looking at the two very best vying for the most coveted prize in their industry, their title. And what amazes me by that is how convoluted and how diluted the product has become in North America, for the simple fact that you have a promoter who wants to run away from what made his business successful in the first place, and that being professional wrestling. I'm all for guys who can talk. I'm all for character development. But at the end of the day, I'm a professional wrestling fan because of what happens once that bell rings. And you are being served in spades if you're a fan of athletic professional wrestling when you watch New Japan Pro Wrestling, because it's not hyperbole. You're looking at the best. You're watching the best of what they do.
Yeah, I have to agree with what you said, too, about, I guess we'll call it North American wrestling, you know, the big W, let's call it. And I know for a fact that there's a lot of MMA fans that just don't like pro wrestling, and I think a lot of that is because of this North American wrestling that we're talking about, as opposed to seeing Japanese wrestling. Like I said, a lot of MMA fans aren't into pro wrestling. What would you say to those people that are not really into the pro wrestling to get them to start watching New Japan?
Well, first of all, I would say that a large majority of all pro wrestling fans, and especially MMA media, grew up professional wrestling fans MMA fans were pro wrestling fans at one time. In my travels, I find that to be the case ad nauseum. But to people who are diehard MMA fans who look at professional wrestling as a joke or aren't fans of what they're being watching on TV in North America, I would say that you should give New Japan Pro Wrestling an opportunity only because of the fact that you will be able to relate to certain aspects of it. And what I'm saying is that New Japan Pro Wrestling really is a tapestry of many different styles. Yes, first and foremost is the strong style, going back to the catch wrestling roots of a guy like Carl Gotch and Josh Barnett's mentor, Billy Robinson, where it was based on, catch wrestling. And that's legit. That's the true form of fighting. And sure, in order to make it dynamic, in order to make it entertaining, you have to add in certain elements. And yet in New Japan, you not only get the strong style, and if that's not your favorite, well, there's elements of lucha libre, the high-flying Mexican style of professional wrestling. There is mixed martial arts. And I had talked to Samoa Joe of TNA a few years ago on my radio show at the time, and I said, in North America, that was the one thing I would have liked to have seen more, and it's now happening because of New Japan and even Ring of Honor. And he agreed, was pro wrestling needed to add more elements of MMA. We've seen what the UFC and mixed martial arts promotions have done now in North America. You have legends like Jim Cornette and Terry Funk saying the UFC is what, professional wrestling used to be and should be, in terms of how it's marketed, and it's all about the title, and it is about, the wins and losses matter, but it's about the storytelling. It's about getting people invested. And I think nowadays, in North America especially, the soap operatic storyline, the bad acting, the putrid comedy, it's not entertaining. At the end of the day, it's not entertaining. And I think if you're going to be a pro wrestling show, then and WWE has an amazing roster. TNA has an amazing roster. ROH. And just let them do. Let the horses run. That's what I want to see. And in New Japan, whether it's it's conducive to longevity or not, and that's always a concern because Hiroshi Tanahashi in his late 30s now and has had many injuries along the way. And the style of wrestling in Japan, yeah, they always have to continue to introduce new stars and attract new blood. But in terms of what we are seeing right now in this era, I get goosebumps thinking about it, the fact that I get to help introduce it to a North American audience, because this is the height. This is the best I've seen in 25 years at least, going back to Flair and Steamboat, no joke.